I want to show this to you. I've been collecting movie ticket stubs since I was 11 years old, and I found this before I left today. My Fight Club stub from 19.
Whoa.
It's kind of hard to see if you look closely.
Oh, yeah, right on there.
It's $1.50.
For November 99, so.
I did.
You didn't get to the first weekend, man.
I did.
What's up?
I know. I be honest, I think I was not 17 yet, so I had to, like,
could be.
Have someone else buy it for me. I love this concept of Keaton's character and how he's struggling with this relevance idea. And this voice keeps telling him, do another Birdman. It'll help you, like, you know, get back on the numbers again. So I'm wondering, as an actor in this business, where is the balance of doing films that make you relevant, but also doing films that you feel are important that you personally want to do?
Well, I think, relevance is, like, a really...
It's vague.
When you're younger and you're getting into this kind of work, there's no question, you know, you look at actors who came before you who meant a lot to you or seemed, you know, relevant to you. To me, that was not the actors who were the biggest box office movie stars. I was drawn to, like, you know, the really great character actors, the people who were kind of redefining acting in the 70s and 80s, and that was my definition of relevance. It might be different from sort of what us movie studio defines as relevant in terms of actors. But that's what. So to me, finding films that either have something to say, or that something about the way they're made is going to be a really interesting experience. Those tend to be the ones that I think are more relevant, you know.
Totally agree.
I think that, you know, you make big movies or you make a different sort of a movie for any number of reasons. Either someone just offers you a lot of money to do it, and you say, well, you know, this is. I'm happy to work in that context because it's an incredible opportunity. In some cases, you know, like I made Red Dragon, which is like a third in a series of Hannibal Lecter films.
Right.
The things, but I really liked Brett Ratner. I thought he was a really compelling person to talk to about the things. But then also, I've wanted to work with Tony Hawkins literally all my life. Ray Fiennes was doing it, Harvey Keitel was doing it, Phil Hoffman, is a friend of mine, was doing it, and sometimes you say, yeah, this is a big commercial film, but there's a lot about what's going into it that's just an experience I want to have. You know, it doesn't matter if it's quote unquote relevant. It's we're gonna pull some really great people together and have an interesting experience making a genre film. You know, so it's the motivations can be really different. I mean. You know, the score is not a relevant movie.
Right, I love that movie,
But someone calls you and says Marlon Brando and Robert De Niro are going to be in a movie and they need a third wheel. You're like, you know, like
sure,
like, you know.
And Smoochie was awesome too, man.
Yeah, but that actually was very original to me. Like that, yeah. not relevant necessarily,
right.
But I laughed my ass off when I read it, and I thought it was really, really unusual. I thought this would be a movie that's not one I've seen before. So, you know, it's sort of what Birdman is about. I think it's kind of what my character says too. If you think too much, if you let your head get wrapped up too much in what other people's view of things are or how it fits within a career, it can really screw you up. You know what I mean? I think. If you're lucky enough to get to make choices and things like that, you really, you know, following your own impulses about the types of experiences you want to have without too much of an eye toward what its kind of
right.
impact is, I think it certainly produces a happier life.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, and if you're lucky, maybe you get to make some good movies, but I think... I went to this thing the other night for Robert De Niro. It was a big Lifetime tribute to Robert De Niro, and I spoke at it and everything. But when, I mean, you know, he said the funniest thing when he got up. He was like, you know, I'm happy to accept this. I still think I got a lot of years in me, and I hope there's value to those. And he said something like, he goes, there's still a lot of bad movies to be made, and we're going to make them. You know what I mean? I thought it was such a funny, but, you know, I knew what he meant, which is just like, you never, you just don't know. You know, you really, even if you're Robert De Niro, really the only attitude you can take is like, hey, like, we're going to take a whack at it, and hopefully some of them will be good.
Yeah.
But probably a lot of them won't. And I just thought it was really funny. You gotta stay humble and keep smiling about it all, because it's if you start to try to treat it like there's some kind of math to this kind of a career, then you're lost, I think.
Yeah. Now, I think the balance of a great filmmaker is someone who can make a movie that helps you appreciate the filmmaking that went into it, but also you never lose your suspension of disbelief in the storyline. I think Wes Anderson does that well. I think that Alejandro does that well, obviously. As an actor in a scene, when they're doing these one continuous shots and making it look that way, does that affect the way you perform in that moment? Do you have to think about where the camera is?
I think it's a combination of things. There's more necessary intimacy and collaboration and preparation, you know, more rehearsal, and it means more a closer collaboration, not only between actors but between those actors and the whole camera team. And
right.
But once you've sort of done that work, I think it's really liberating, because the truth is that I find it more exhausting and challenging to try to play through a scene, no matter what type of scene it is, and constantly break and shift and do it again and change angle, because the retaining concentration and retaining the energy and the inspiration through all those artificial, you know, deconstructions that go on normally in a film, you just, all that gets thrown out the window, and it's like you get to just bring it all in this kind of real-time through line. I thought that was kind of wonderful.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at some of your earlier films, though, and you had the opportunity to shoot them this way, like, how different would Fight Club or American History X be if you were to shoot it in this free-flowing environment?
Well, it's funny. I mean, I remember, it'd be very different. I mean, when we were doing this, a lot of us were looking at each other and going, man, you know, it highlights how lazy we all are, or how unsure of themselves sometimes directors are, because really the reason they're doing all this is because they need the insurance package later of being able to make adjustments. One of the things that was so amazing, you talked about Chivo and Alejandro, you have to be really at the absolute top of your powers, the peak of your powers. Watching them do this and eliminate the opportunity later to make changes was like watching masters at painting. You know, they were, you have to be supremely confident to do things that you cannot alter later. And I felt like we were watching two guys, you know, who are at the top of their game.
Totally.
Which was really cool. And just different. It's fun to do anything that you've done a lot of times in a really different way.